Good morning. Today we will study about geology and its applications in civil engineering. That's why we will study about engineering geology, which has some geology's applications in civil engineering. Content. First of all, we will study about scope of engineering geology, geology and civil engineering, earth processes, the layer of earth, the layers of atmosphere. In scope of engineering geology, we will discuss about the scope of geology in civil engineering. For example, how geology applications or learnings can help a civil engineer to know about earth better. Second, geology and civil engineering, we'll discuss about the relevance of geology in civil engineering, such as contour maps, hydrological maps, and earth layer, etc. In earth processes, we'll discuss about various earth processes which help earth to form the climates and to move around the different tectonic plates and different earth calamities. The layer of earth, we'll discuss about the different layer of earth starting from the crust to the inner mantle core. In layers of atmosphere, we'll discuss about the different layers of atmosphere such as troposphere, stratosphere, and so on. So we'll start with scope of engineering geology. Geology is a science of earth. It is not a basic science like mathematics, physics, chemistry, or biology, but it is an application of basic sciences to earth. So geology is not a basic science. Instead, it's an application of those basic science to the earth. Second, the geology, we have to deal geology in these four different aspects. First of all, civil engineering. Second, mining engineering. Third, petroleum engineering. And fourth, environmental engineering. So geology engineering have applications in civil engineering, mining, petroleum, and environment respectively. In civil engineering, we have to take knowledge of geology in roads, foundation, tunnels, slopes, and drains. In mining engineering, potash, gold, uranium, coal, such as the deposits of these four minerals, will help the mining engineer to know better about its locations. Petroleum, oil, natural gas, tar sands, and oil shells. So for a petroleum engineer, geology will help know the whereabouts of the oil, natural gas, and various things and its deposit. In environmental engineering, we will deal with groundwater, leachates, contaminants, pollution, and remediation. So the application of geology in environmental engineering is to know the groundwater table, where up to which depth the groundwater table is, the different types of wastes, contaminants which contaminate the water bodies, pollution, and remediations. So engineering geology may be defined as branch of applied science which deals with the applications of geology for a safe and economic design and construction of civil engineering. So we use the geological knowledge geological knowledge and its application for safe and economic design and construction of civil engineering projects. So what are the objectives? The objective is it enables civil engineer to know or to understand engineering application of certain condition related to the area of construction which are essentially geological in nature. So some conditions are geological in nature. So to understand that better, a civil engineer has to have a study or learn about the geology. Also, it enables geologists to understand the nature of geological information that is absolutely essential for the safe design and construction of the engineering. Likewise, it also helps geologists to understand various information which is needed to for the construction of safe construction of sewage projects. The aspect of geology has full relevance in all the three aspects of each construction, such as planning, designing, and execution. So, in geology, the three aspects in geology has geology have applications in all the three aspects of a construction project, such as planning, designing, and execution. So, one by one, we'll deal with everyone. Planning, geological information is greatly useful in planning and engineering project. It will help to know the various information beforehand about the site conditions, which are essentially geological in nature, such as topographical maps. The topographical are the maps of a given site, the different site conditions, such as depth of valleys, contours, slopes, size, and gorges. So these are the information. If we know beforehand, it will be helpful for engineer to do the construction, the safe construction on this site. Second, hydrological map. If a cement engineer knows the distribution of distribution and geometry of the water tables at the site condition, he can use or exploit the water on that particular site to the maximum use. Also, the occurrence of depth contour of groundwater. Along with the distribution, it helps the engineer to understand the water table, the depth of water table from the earth's ground surface, and also how to exploit that water or use that water for the site. Geological maps. Petrological characters and structural depositions of rock types as developed in the proposed area depicted in geological maps. So, for geological maps, the different types of rock deposits, if a engineer knows that this particular rock is deposited in great number in this, so he can use that knowledge and extract as many rocks as he want and use it in construction projects. So, he need not have to buy from other place and transport it, which will increase the project cost. Now, in designing, some of the geological characteristics that have direct or indirect bearing on the design of a proposed project. So, there are many characters that have direct or indirect impact on the design of the proposed project. So, if students know the design and the challenges it will face during execution or design of that project, he will be better equipped to handle that. So there are various earth processes which are plate tectonics, climate change, and ocean circulation. These are the three major earth processes which drive the change in earth, land, air, and oceans. These changes can have both beneficial and harmful effect on Earth's climate. So these three major earth processes have beneficial and the bad impact on the Earth's surface or its climate. Number one, plate tectonics. A German meteorologist named Alfred Wegener proposed the theory of continental drift. Based on his theory on matching of coastlines of South America and Africa, as well as the plant and animal forces found on different continents. So the Alfred, he has investigated the fossils and the plant fossils of plant and animal, and after knowing that South American continent and the Africa continent have similar fossils and plants grown in its area, so he draw the theory that South America and Africa was initially one continent, and then due to the various earth processes it got separated from each other and formed two different continents. Now, the earth lithosphere. Earth lithosphere consists of plates that ride on hotter or mobile material. In geological terms, a plate is large slab of solid rock. Word tectonic is derived from a Greek word named tubin and refers to the deformation of earth crust. Earth has seven large plates and a dozen of smaller plates. The plates are generally internally rigid and move related to each other. Each plate is about 80 km or 50 miles thick and consists of shallow part that deforms by elastic bending or by brittle breaking, and a deeper part made of material that deforms without rupturing, or like say plastic deformation. By using GPS, we can determine the direction and date of the movement. And around plate tectonics move around 13 cm per year. So tectonic plates can move into or away from or past one another. These are the three basic movements of a tectonic plate, which are moving to, away from, or past one another. So these three movements have its own names. The names are convergent, when they move into, spreading, when they move apart, and if they pass under, it will be a transform. So these three names are given to the three movements of the plate tectonics. The two of the most common forms of convergent margins or boundaries are subduction zones and collision zones. So when there is a convergent phenomenon takes place, there will be two outcomes. One they are subduction and collisions. Subduction occurs when a higher density plate moves beneath a lower density plate and plunges as much as several hundred kilometers into Earth's interior. So subduction occurs when a tectonic plate of relative higher density moves into a lower density plate, and it moves under several hundred kilometers. So this process known as subduction. On the west coast of South America, for example, the Nazca plate drives underneath the South American plate. So this is an example how Nazca plate drives underneath the South American plate. So that was one subduction, a part of convergence. Another is collision. So collision occurs when two plates of relatively low density converge and neither can be subducted into the denser deep earth. So when subduction is not possible because of the relatively low density plates, so they collide each other. Once they collide with such a great force that they form mountains, and those are dramatic effects or consequences of the collision which occurs between two different plates of different continents. So it's a very gradual process. It's not very quick process, so it will take millions of years to have collision between two different plates. The Himalayan mountains and the Tibetan plateaus were forced when the Indian plate moved northward and collided within the Eurasian plate. So when Indian subcontinent plate, tectonic plate, moves toward the Eurasian plate and collided with it, the result of that was the mountains formed in the Tibet and the Nepal region, the Himalaya region, and from there only we got the highest peak of the Earth, which is Mount Everest, which is around 8800 meters. Recently, in the earthquake of Nepal, the same thing happened. The Indian subcontinent plate collided northward towards the Eurasian plate, and the earthquake came. And as a result of that earthquake, the height of the Mount Everest is further increased by 3 to 4 meters. Most spreading margins are deep under the oceans. Margins means the boundaries. They occur where hot magma from Earth's interior spews into the mid-oceanic ridges between plates and forms the new oceanic plate and material. The example is Mid-Atlantic Ridge. So when there is a boundary, two different boundary of the oceanic plate below the ocean, so once they go apart, move apart, there will be space left vacant. That space is filled by the lava, the magma which comes from the earth interior and fills that part. So that part is filled by the lava or the magma which comes from beneath the earth, and that forms the new oceanic plate. That is a new oceanic plate material. So there will be the material deposition, and it will then eventually turn into igneous rocks. Mid-Atlantic Ridge is the example of that. This is between North American and Eurasian plate. So the transform margins occurs when one plate slides past another. That means if there are two plates like this, so one move like this and another move like this. So it is the one plate slide past another. So one plate just slides the another plates. The most familiar example of this way, this is San Andreas Fault Zone on the west coast of North America, or let's say California, near California, where the Pacific plate slides northward relative to the North American plate. So this is transformation. And if I say about the convergent, convergent is the subduction. One subduction will be like this. One plate will go down past the another plate. So this is going down, and this is, let's say, plate 1, this is plate 2. So if plate 2 is going down, so it is subduction. And if that two plates are colliding, each other, then the mountains will form if it collides further into it. So this is the process. This is a collision. So this is collision. Because of this, the mountain will form, and because of this only, the Himalayan ranges and Mount Everest or Tibetan plateau ranges form, and Hindu Kush also. Now, another earth process is weathering. Weathering is the breaking up of surfaces by forces such as the air and water of the atmosphere. So weathering is the breaking up of surfaces by forces such as air and water. Weathering process causes the breakup of rock materials into earth uppermost layer. So the earth contains uppermost layer contains mountains and different the silica and other material. So those rock materials break up into smaller, and that the phenomena which breaks that, the carrier or the agent of that are air and water. So they help to break the rocks, big rocks, into small particles, and then they carried away with them so that deposition can take place at the other places. So there are essentially two forms of weathering. One is mechanical weathering, the expansion and contraction caused by sudden large changes in temperature, the expansive force of water freezing in cracks, the splitting caused by plant roots and the impact of running water. So this is how a mechanical weathering takes place. It is essentially takes place for the expansion and the contraction of the rock particle because of the fall in temperature, the rise and fall in temperature, and the splitting of the rock because of the plant growth, the roots of plant growth, which forces rock or the earth crust to break apart to create some space for themselves. So this is the because of this only the mechanical weathering take place. Water may enter cracks in the road surface. When this water freezes overnight, it expands and widens the crack. This is how the crack widens further and further and breaks into smaller things. So because of the frost, the water which was already present in the pores of the cracks freezes, and if it freezes, the same volume of ice will occupy 9% more than the volume occupied by the same amount of or same volume of liquid water. So it forces further and breaks the further deepens the crack and then ultimately breaks the rock. Usually in forests, roots of plant reach to cracks in rocks by their penetration and growth. So the roots in the forest will reach the cracks already present on the surface or like surface or at the depth of the earth crust in the rocks, and they further growth into those cracks and forces the rock to break apart. This is how the plant roots breaking process takes place. Another is chemical weathering. Other weathering processes are chemical. So one after mechanical weathering, there is another process which is chemical weathering. For example, oxidation, hydration, carbonation, and loss of chemical elements by solution into water. So these are the various the processes take place, or the chemical that takes place. One is oxidation, another is hydration, and consumer. These three primarily these three. The chemical weathering take place. It will change the color and shape of the rock. So it triggers the change in color and the shape of the rock through the oxidation, hydration, and carbonation processes. Now the air. In dry areas, wind carry sand that much like sandpaper. So that much behaves like a sandpaper. So when air takes a small sand sediments with them or sand particles with them, it collide with the bigger rocks, and that sand will behave like a sandpaper. So it will just pass through the rock, and sometimes it collide with the rock, and during the collision and throughout the gradual process of the air flowing in the sediments, the big rocks will break up into small sediments of the rocks and further taken away by water as erosion. So the broken rocks must also be carried away. So the air also carry away the small particles which broke after the process. Erosion. Erosion is another process. Erosion is a natural process which is usually made by rock and soil being loosened from the earth's surface at one location and move to under. So erosion is essentially a process where water behaves as an agent, and it takes the broken up particles of rock from one place to another place, and it helps to form to change the landscape on earth's surface, bringing down mountains and filling in valleys and making river appear and disappear. So this is the major changes in the earth crust. It is usually a slow and gradual process that occurs over thousands of millions of years. So erosion is a very gradual and slow process. So it takes millions and thousands of years to change the landscape. So weathering can take place by erosion as well. Water is liquid form causes erosion in the material. So weathering can take place with the help of erosion also. So the erosion means the carried away of small particles of rock to in from one place to another place. So the weathering, which is essentially help earth to form different landscape, to even to break mountains and to form the valleys and plateaus and all. So erosion is one form in which a weathering can take place. Water also plays major role, especially in sea, especially sea water. Sea waves that are constantly hitting the land are carrying the sand away with them out to the sea. So one nowadays we are seeing that the beaches, the coastline also daily decreasing because of constantly hitting of sea waves and breaking up of the rock particles which are on the coastline. So this the sea, this the level of sea is increasing, and the force with which the sand, the sea waves strikes the coastline is increasing, and it's further breaking up, breaking away slowly, slowly, or eroding away slowly with the coastline. So these are the different plates which we have learned about prior as tectonic plates. So this is Nazca plate, Pacific plate, South American plate, Caribbean plate, Arabian plate, Eurasian plate, Indian plate, and where? So there are, these are the major plates which exist on globe, on Earth. And this is Earth, the globe map, or the Earth map, world map. So this shows where exactly the plates are. Now we will study about the layers of Earth. The upper layer of the Earth called crust, which is 0 to 100 km. Then after the crust we have mantle. This mantle is about 2900 km. Now after the mantle we have outer core, which is around 51 km, from 2900 km to 5100 km, and the inner core, which is the metallic core, is about from 5100 km to 6378 km. So the inner core is solid in nature, outer core is semi-solid or liquid in nature, the mantle is semi-solid and plastic in nature, and the lithosphere, or let's say crust, is solid in nature. So we have studied about the four major layers, which are crust, upper mantle, lower mantle, inner core, and outer core. So the Earth composed of four different layers: the crust, the mantle, the outer and inner core of the Earth. So the outer core is the outermost, the outer part of the Earth, from center to if you move from center to upper. The inner core is the inner part of the core. The mantle is the outer, from the part which is just below the crust level, and the crust is the topmost part of the Earth surface. Then the oceans and the continents are further going up. If you go up, crust is only about 8 kilometers thick under the ocean, which we also say as ocean crust, and about 32 kilometers thick under the continents. So the crust of Earth, which is around 5 to 6 kilometer depth or 8 kilometer depth, we name as oceanic crust, and the lithosphere crust, or like the crust which is under continent, is around 32 kilometers. So these are the lithosphere plates, means the plates which essentially contains the Earth crust and various continents. The crust of the Earth is broken into many pieces called plates, and the plates float on the soft or semi-rigid atmosphere. So atmosphere is a layer which have essentially a liquid mantle on which the various plates flow, collide, converge and transform. This is atmosphere. Atmosphere, we have atmosphere. This is as a lithosphere and this is as an atmosphere. Atmosphere means essentially a liquid mantle which have convecting currents. Through that convecting currents, convecting currents will be like this. In the atmosphere. So once it current flows like this, it will be the layer above this try to move forward. So if this we say plate, it moves above the convecting above this layer. So the convection current currents force the plate to move forward. So because of this only various the plates, tectonic plates move past each other, collide each other. So because of that convecting current in mantle, it forms. The convecting current arises in the atmosphere because of its hot nature. So it is like hot liquid, that's why it happens. Like a hot asphalt. So this is lithosphere, the crust and the upper layer of the mantle. The crust and the upper layer of the mantle together make up a zone of rigid brittle rock called lithosphere. So the upper layer of mantle, which is semi-solid in nature, and the crust, which is solid in nature. So these two forms the lithosphere. The crust is composed of two rocks. Continental crust is mostly granite. Oceanic crust is basalt. Basalt is much denser than the granite because of this less dense continents rise on the oceanic plates, denser oceanic plates. Now we talk about mantle. The mantle is the largest layer of earth, which is this one from here to here, which has inner mantle and two further subparts, inner mantle and outer mantle. So outer mantle is relatively semi-solid in nature and less hotter than the inner mantle. And the inner mantle will be essentially a liquid in nature and much more hotter than the outer mantle. We also tell this mantle layer as atmosphere. So what are the convection currents? The middle mantle, or so let's say inner mantle, flows because of the convection currents. The convection currents are those caused by the very hot material at the deepest part of the mantle rising, then cooling and sinking again, repeating the cycle over and over. So because of this, it will first of all, because of the hot, it will rise, then it will cool and come again. So if it is rising, move to the top, then comes down, and again the same process will take place, which moves the plate upper, the plate resting on that particular liquid forward. So this is how this happens. Similarly, this process is named as convection currents. For example, if we put a cork here and heat the water, when water boils, the water will try to move in such a direction and it will force the cork to move forward. This is exactly what happens in the inner mantle or middle mantle. So the outer core. The core of the earth is like a ball of very hot metal. The outer core is so hot that the metal and they are all in liquid state. The outer core is composed of the melted metals of nickel and iron. So the outer coat is mainly comprised of liquid iron and nickel, liquid nickel. So we have already seen the depth of this core. This is the outer core, and beneath this we have inner solid core. This is the inner. The next is the central one is inner core. Inner core of the earth has temperature and pressure so great that the metal are squeezed together and are not able to move about like a liquid, but are forced to vibrate in place like a solid. So the pressure is so huge that they are not. The pressure forces that metal, iron and nickel, to remain in a solid state. It vibrates, but it does not move like we have seen the upper metal or inner metal like conductive currents, because it's solid in nature. Now, the Earth atmosphere, which is last one. Earth atmosphere is like a thin gaseous envelope. The atmosphere is a thin layer of air that protects the Earth surface from extreme temperature and harmful stress rays. So the atmosphere of Earth protects us or our world from the harmful rays from the sun. What does atmosphere comprises? It is a mixture of gases, solid and liquids. Early atmosphere was much different than today. Volcanoes produced nitrogen and carbon dioxide, but little oxygen. So volcanoes essentially produces nitrogen and carbon dioxide and very little oxygen. More than 2 billion years ago, early organisms began producing oxygen. So more than 2 billion years ago, many organisms started producing oxygen, and since then we have a good amount of oxygen in the earth atmosphere, almost around 22% in color. Eventually, oxygen formed an ozone layer that protected earth from harmful rays. So this is because of the formation of oxygen, that the two oxygen gas flying under the lightning pressure, and that fusion take place. So is that exactly like an electric arc? So the fusion takes place, and those fusion, O2 will fuse with O molecule and form O3 molecule, which is ozone, and it forms on the stratosphere layer, almost on the top of the stratosphere layer, which protects the Earth surface from the harmful rays, the radiations, ultraviolet radiations. Atmospheric gases, the nitrogen is 17%, oxygen is around 21%. Water vapor 0.4%, carbon dioxide 0.37%, argon 0.93%, phases of neon, helium, methane, and krypton, xenon, and other gases. So the remaining are these gases, very small in numbers. So these numbers can vary approximately, but essentially if we put it to round figure, it will be nearly like this only. Now, from where to where troposphere lies? Troposphere will lie from 0 to almost passing just 10 kilometers. Then stratosphere will be around, let's say, 15 kilometers, from 15 to 50 kilometers. And mesosphere will be 50 something greater than 50 kilometers up to 85 kilometers. And from there, 85 to 500 kilometers will be exosphere. So now we'll study about one by one each layer. Troposphere, lowest layer, it's the lowest layer, extends up to 10 km, up to 10 km, let's say some 12 km, 15 km maximum. Contains 99% of water vapor and 75% of atmospheric gases. It contains most clouds and half of the Earth's atmosphere. Weather occurs in this layer. So climate change sometimes is in this layer only. Most of the layers heat is from Earth. temperature goes about 6.5 degrees Celsius per kilometer of altitude. So while we go up in the altitude, the temperature will cool and the rate of cooling will be around 6.5 degrees per kilometer if we go from down to upward, or if we rise. Next is stratosphere, directly above troposphere. So stratosphere is directly above stratosphere. It extends from 10 km to 50 km above the Earth's surface. The portion of the upper layer contains high levels of gas called ozone. So as I said before, or we studied before, stratosphere essentially contains ozone, which helps to protect Earth's surface from the harmful ultraviolet rays. What ozone do? Ozone layer absorbs harmful rays from the sun. Most of the jet aircrafts fly in the stratosphere because it is very stable. As maximum air or the maximum amount of gases contained in the troposphere, so it is more turbulent in nature. But stratosphere is from 10 meters to its above, it will be relatively much stable than the troposphere. That's why most of the aircrafts fly in this stratosphere layer. Now next is mesosphere, extend from top of the stratosphere to about 85 km above the Earth. This mesosphere also contains ionosphere layer, which help us to pass the radio waves. So we pass radio waves through this through the ionosphere, or like ion, the layer which contains ions. Oldest layer with little ozone. Mesosphere is oldest layer which has very little amount of ozone in it. Meteors or rock fragments burn up in the mesosphere. Ionosphere, as I said, ionosphere, mesosphere also in ionosphere, and it helps us propagating the radio waves or carrying the radio waves. Now the last layer is exosphere, thickest atmospheric layer. It is the thickest atmospheric layer found above 85 km up to 70 km above the Earth's surface. The thermosphere is a layer with auroras known for its high temperature. So it is very high temperature. So up to a certain altitude in troposphere, the temperature decreases, after that it will increase, and it increases with a high margin. Warm set, it filters out X-ray and gamma rays from sun. So it filters out X-ray and gamma rays from sun. This exosphere filters out X-rays and gamma rays from the sun. And ionosphere, as I said, ionosphere is essentially part of mesosphere, but this extends up to exosphere, which helps to carry about radio waves. So we have seen here different types of Earth layer, and this Earth, if we study about Earth layer as a geological parameter in symmetry, we will understand better about the Earth and biota. So we have studied various details about the geology and its applications in civil engineering, and we'll be continuing with this in the next lecture. Thank you.